Hello. Welcome to Struggles of the Spirit. This is your host, the Reverend Lee Udell. I'm glad you've tuned in to this program today, and we look forward to interesting you on our subject. And the subject is, why should people bother to worship with other people like once a week on the Sabbath? Why should they do that? Why not just stay home and read a good book, go for a walk in the woods, do your own private prayers at home, and not go off and be with other people who are praying? Why get involved in being a member of a congregation? Why not just do your own personal spiritual thing? And there are lots of answers to this question, and we've been having different guests on the program addressing these different answers and different thoughts. And we're going to do some more of the same today. But I want to invite you first to phone in from time to time here during the program as you see fit. If you have a comment or a response to what we're saying to you, please give us a ring. Our phone number is 658-5165. 658-5165. And we'll bring your voice right here into the studio. It'll be heard on the television program, and we'll talk with you and hopefully give you some good response. Our special guest today is the Reverend Mark Follansbee. He's been a friend and a colleague for many years. He's a Vermonter, obviously, and has been active in the United Church of Christ ever since I've known you. Anyway, you were the pastor at Montpelier.
Yes, 12 years.
12 years. I remember when I thought of that church, I thought of you, and vice versa. You know. And then you came down here to the lowlands of the Champlain Valley, I guess. And
I retired here almost 15 years ago.
And you've been doing JUMP, you did in the past.
I did in the past, the Joint Urban Ministry Project, yes.
Some people don't know anything about that. You might just mention what that is.
JUMP is the Joint Urban Ministry Project is the outreach of, in my day, 10 congregations, from Jewish to Unitarian, and a good smattering of traditional churches in them. And the reason was to be there for people in need in our community of Greater Burlington.
What kind of need do you use?
Well, people would come to us for help with food and for transportation and for mm-hmm. rent, and as it developed over it, also they came to us for things like diapers and baby food and bus passes, help with transportation, some medical emergencies that we could give small help to.
The practical things of life.
Yes, but it developed that the greatest thing of the Joint Urban Ministry, is, from my perspective anyway, was the fact that we were there for people and we welcomed them. And we practiced hospitality. And it was a great place for people to come and visit and have a cup of coffee and know that they were welcomed and they'd be listened to.
So it's a social center too, then, you might say?
Yes.
And a place where people are respected even though they are not dressed in the kind of clothes that the others wear. They don't feel strange about coming to a church on Winooski Avenue and discussing their need.
Well, I'm sure some did. There was certainly no dress code. our object was to let people know that they were just as fully human as the way they were. And of course, that's the way we are received by God.
Of course, God has no favorites. No right. dress code in heaven. And if there were, at least by ancient standards, we would be found lacking. I have no sandals. I have no no desert clothing on me at all.
You don't even have a beard.
No, I don't even have a beard. It was shocking.
Yeah.
So, Mark, tell us about your own response to the question about why people go to synagogue, church, temple, to worship. Why do that when, as the saying goes, you know, there's a lot of hypocrites there, or there people are often are just there because their parents did, or their grandparents did, or it's good for business, or you know, all kinds of reasons, and therefore, why should I go and spend time worshiping in that kind of a community? You know, you've heard this a thousand times.
I have. But one comment is that if I'm told that the people don't go to church because there are too many hypocrites there, I like to tell them there's always room for one more.
I mean, we who go to a worship center, we acknowledge that we are sometimes hypocrites, you're saying.
Well, we don't go with any purity of motive or... But I also need to tell you that I hate why questions. And I hate them because they are indeed invasive. But I can talk about why I go, but I can't tell about why you should go or anybody else.
Well, tell us about why you go. That's fine for me.
Yeah. I'd be glad to.
Delighted to hear.
And it's out of need. It's an awareness of my need. And my need is to be in a safe place where I'm welcomed. I'm a part of it, just as I am. That I have something to give, and I have some needs that can be fulfilled within the congregation, by the people of the congregation. And there's also this very deeper need to realize that the spirit that draws me to recognize my need and to be open to other people is the spirit of the living God.
Mm-hmm.
That is in every one of us. But I need to be open to the fact that not only to the members of the congregation, but to that spirit. In fact, it's by that spirit that I can even recognize my need and know that the loneliness and the yearning that's in me is really the work of the Spirit calling me to what I call home. And I think of home as a relationship, not as a place. Home is a relationship.
It's not the building itself.
It's not the building. It's not the service itself. It's the relationship in that space and in that time we call worship. The relationship I have with the people with whom I gather and with God.
Mm-hmm.
That's, yes.
So a double relationship, one with others and one with God. You that's what leads you to go and worship weekly.
Yes, and it's taken me, I'm 79 years old, and it's taken me almost, maybe 65 years to begin to realize that need.
Mm-hmm.
I was drawn to worship much earlier in my life, but not out of a sense of the need.
Well, then what was the need, if I may ask, if it wasn't out of your own need?
What drew me?
Mm.
Well, of course, I began because I was dragged there by my parents.
You're an honest man. Some parents do that.
Well, mine did, and
yeah.
My need at the time was to try to get out of there. but some things were happening to me there that I probably wouldn't acknowledge at the time.
In spite of your parents dragging you there.
And so when I left home, I left going to worship. And I went through the war.
Which one, now? World War II?
My war was World War II. And with a sense that I didn't need the church, but I was increasingly conscious of the, at least awed before, the sense of God, of the mystery of it all. And I spent many, many days at sea just in wonder. But I didn't think I needed the church. And when I came back and was in the insurance business and married, one of my customers asked me to usher a church, and I thought it would be prudent. So my need was to hang on to an account.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
It was...
Again, I salute your honesty.
Well, it's very obvious, you know, because I would go and do my duties of ushering and then sit on the steps and smoke until the service was over.
Oh, you wouldn't stay inside.
I wouldn't stay until we had a son, and he was baptized, and my wife said, she had said, we've got to have Mark baptized. And I said, why? There's that why question. And she said, because everybody has their child baptized. And I said, well, then we won't. But we went and we talked to our minister. And that was a turning point in my life. So I began at least to sit down and for the whole service and listen.
Mm-hmm. Including the sermon.
I felt that that my need then was to hear something in the sermon. The worship itself was just kind of frosting for the sermon.
So what is it that changed your opinion about your need for others in worship? What brought about the change as the years went by?
Well, I remember one thing I do remember was in my second parish was in a college community in Minnesota.
Mm-hmm.
And they had Sunday evening worship in the chapel.
Mm-hmm.
And I would attend that. And again, it was kind of exciting to be a part of a college community for me. But I had this experience. We had what we would call the pastoral prayer.
Mm-hmm.
That ended with us all joining in the Lord's Prayer.
Mm-hmm.
And as I said with others, Our Father, it occurred to me, we need to pray, I need to pray with others.
It just was a recognition.
Yes, that recognition.
But
I was praying as an individual in the pastoral prayers, or at least I was listening to the minister's prayer.
You were still not ordained yet.
I was ordained then.
You were, okay.
Yeah, I was ordained. But again, I thought pretty much that the minister's job was to preach, and conducting worship was part of the went along with it.
Mm-hmm.
It wasn't that simple, of course.
No.
But my need seemed to be centered on them. On the sermon, whether I was sitting in a pew or standing in the pulpit. I think it's just the recognition as I went along in life that I'm not an independent being. And that recognition came because of failures to be myself.
Mm-hmm.
Alone.
Mm-hmm.
Part of it was a failure in marriage. And in a marriage where I thought that I was responsible for the health of that marriage, because I was, I suppose, because I was a man and because I was a clergy person. And it's that kind of a failure.
Made you doubt some of your presuppositions, you mean?
Yes. Thank you.
Hmm.
Another thing that happened, this is along the lane, that the growing recognition of need is that when I retired from the church in Montpelier, Bethany Church, 15 years ago, it'll be 15 years ago, January 1st, I went on a solo trip around the country by myself. And part of my task was to say, what do I need now that I'm a single person and retired? Mm-hmm. Part of it was looking around the country for places to, as possible places for me to live. But I came to the recognition that I had needs. I had three needs that I identified very strongly. One, I had a need for solitude.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. I think that's a need that a lot of people don't realize they have that kind of need.
Yeah. And being alone helped me to recognize that that was a time that I could meet a need.
Mm-hmm.
I had a need for an intimate relationship with a woman. But I also recognized that I needed a purposeful community. I needed to be part of a community with a purpose, that I was a part of the purpose. And I realized for me that that was the church. And that I needed to be interactive with people.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
Another factor, I think, Lee, was you got me to be a part-time chaplain in a cancer rehabilitation team. That was between 1975 and 78.
Right. It was a while there at the now Fletcher Allen.
Yeah. And I found myself as a clergy person in a medical team and wondering what was my role as part of the team. And I learned that I had something that everybody else needed. If we were going to understand what was happening to the people in our care. And I had something, and I needed to be part of what everybody else was offering. And that I needed that team. Yeah. I had that need before. I've recently been on a reunion, as I've told you, of the submarine I served on, and I look back on that, and the recognition of there was the great thing to me was to be part of a team. Everybody was needed.
I guess on a submarine, very, very much so.
Yeah, and we were trained in the hope that we could take anybody's job and do it. That was theory, at least. But I didn't recognize that at the time. I was still very much concerned about me and what should I do by myself, and what is it required of me as an individual. And
mm-hmm.
But the cancer rehab team, and I'm grateful to you for
thank you
leading me into that, because it was one of the dramatic experiences of my life, and just in the recognition of my need to be me. And to be me, I have to be with other people in a purposeful relationship.
As I remember that team, we had a strong sense of solidarity, a strong
yes.
team membership.
Yeah. And we had a psychiatrist on board whose
sure.
role was to help us be a team, because it's not easy.
No, and we had, all of us had different professional backgrounds we were all coming from.
Yeah. I don't know. There's a mystery to it. I think that's one of the reasons I don't like why questions.
Well, I can't answer ever for anyone else,
no,
ultimately.
But there's a mystery. I mean, I'm even answering for myself. There's this mystery, and I can just say it's in the mystery, the Spirit is trying to say something for me, that's related to what it's trying to, the Spirit's trying to say for all of us.
And you're telling us here this morning that the Spirit is communicating, you know, because you are telling us what you have concluded for yourself.
Yes. Yeah.
That's neat.
But I want to get back to it, the sense of belonging in a purposeful community. And for me, that is a congregation that itself needs to be part of the church in capital T, capital C. So that I need you as an Episcopal priest. And we need to live together and work together and respond to the Spirit together. But the focus for me has to be, you know, the beginning of that has to be the openness to the Spirit and the call within that in a particular congregation.
One of the most profound experiences I've ever had, really, was being a participant at a Jewish internment of a parishioner, and this was of a person who was a member of a local synagogue. I knew them because I was hospital chaplain, and this lady who died was a patient of mine. So we had a double relationship. The rabbi saw her, and I saw her, and we were not in competition with each other. We both knew that this lady wanted to see both of us for some reason, and I mean, particularly in terms of me not being a rabbi, and but she wanted us both. And at her internment at the cemetery, I guess I was the only non-Jewish person there, that as far as I knew, and there were many, many people from the synagogue who were there, and the men had yarmulkes on, and they were, of course, Jewish prayers. But then when it came time to bury her, you know, we all her casket was lowered into the grave, and we all took long-handled shovels and we filled in the whole grave, and everyone took turns, and it was a sense of family like I've never felt before at an internment, that we were all one together, and it was a very profound, humbling experience to feel a member like that.
Yes. I have a daughter-in-law who is a Jew, raised as a Jew, but not very religious, except for the high holidays. But she, coming out of a crisis in her life, went through the process of bat mitzvah.
Uh-huh.
And my son, her husband, who's a Buddhist, incidentally, went through that process with her and had some part of the service. Mm. His brothers and mother were there, and but what it meant to me is, you know, they're part of this larger purposeful community of which I'm a part, and
You know, Mark, as you think about it, without those kinds of identifications, those kinds of belongings, being a member of a congregation in one way or another, like at that Jewish internment, I'm not a Jew, but I was welcomed as a member, you know, and and I felt that way. Without that kind of membership, we're all alone, you know. If I had no relationship with anyone else like that, I would be all alone, except for in Vermont, like deer camp, you know, at that time, this time of the year, there's a fraternity. I don't know about how much it's sorority, but there's the men, certain men who like to hunt, they get together and they hunt together. And I guess there are other activities like bowling or ice fishing, but that's a bit solitary, I guess, ice fishing. I'm trying to think of things that we do in a collegial kind of group way for adults. I mean, children have a lot of things, but once they've got their 30s or 40s, a lot of those group things disappear. And without the religious connection of a congregation, it's just me, you know, maybe my family, but that's a small congregation, I guess, the family. I don't know, I'm interested in your thoughts about that. It seems kind of lonely without some connection like that.
Well, it's not for me to say, except out of my own experience.
No, I'm talking about how I feel right now.
Yeah, and I need camaraderie. I was part of a non-church men's group for 8 years, every Sunday night for 2 hours.
What held the group together?
Well, it was a recognition of common need. There wasn't any recognition of transcendence, but there was a common recognition of the spiritual dimension of what we were doing, and of our need for one another. And it was not only supportive, but in many ways a transforming experience for us.
Mm-hmm.
There were several divorces, and one death of a wife 2 days after the child was born.
Wow.
Because we lived through these experiences together, we raised that child. This is the men's group, you know, when that child was a very small baby, she was a part of the group every Sunday night. And but we grew as individuals,
so
because we were in that sharing mode, and we were honest with one another. So I mentioned earlier a safe place.
Mm-hmm. I noticed that word, safe.
And it was safe in the sense that we could be ourselves.
Let your hair down.
And let the hair down, but also let the heart out.
Mm-hmm.
And your microphone has just fallen down.
Thank you.
It's on your lap, I think, yeah.
Thank you.
My experience is that in the world in general, it's pretty risky to be myself, to really share who I am with. It leads to pain. And there are some experiences where one has to risk it, knowing
mm-hmm.
that pain will be there.
Mm-hmm.
But it's supportive to be a part of a safe group.
It was a form
of that experience of being yourself, of sharing who I really am and how I feel about myself and about others and about what's going on. I don't have to play like it's that I feel otherwise. I don't have to agree with you
mm-hmm.
in order
mm-hmm.
to be your friend.
Mm-hmm. Right.
I don't have to please you to be your friend. I'll be your friend as you and I are friends as we
sure.
build a relationship.
Sure.
And you can't do that everywhere.
No, that's true. That's true.
And, you know, a great deal of what men do is competitive.
We're raised to be competitive in our society.
Even, I mean, the deer camp,
mm.
They're that competitive.
I got an 8-pointer.
Yeah.
You only got a four-pointer?
Yeah. The sports, whole sports scene, it's so filled with what people, I think, identify as a need to win.
Yeah.
And that means winning over. Yep. That is a separation process. Competitiveness is separation. And I don't mind, I'm a competitive human being. And there are times when it's important. And I love to get into, I love to mix it up. But I also know it's not a creative enterprise, it's a destructive in terms of the human spirit and relationships. And it's always risky.
I've never been into popular sports myself very much. My son has a bit more, but he was into sprints and running, not team sports necessarily. Passing the baton, a relay race that way, yes, but not at, like football, not like baseball or soccer or hockey. I can't speak knowledgeably about the subject because I've not experienced a lot of the world of sports, but I gather, at least when you're into some of the sports, like my son was, you're competing more against yourself, or against your best time, you know, or maybe the best time of someone else. But it's not so much you're trying to get another touchdown and beat the opposing team. It's sort of a different kind of philosophy.
Well, I'll speak to that. Because I wasn't in track, but I was a competitive swimmer in high school and in college. And as a result of that, a number of years later, in a college town, I was asked by the boys in the high school, which did not have a swimming team, if I would form a team and coach them.
Ah.
And we did it three years, getting up at using the pool at 6 o'clock in the morning, the college pool.
Wow.
And in my third year, a friend, a member of the congregation I served, who was a track coach in the high school and a math teacher, volunteered to join me. And from him I learned that what he was interested in is the competition with self that you speak of. But I didn't feel that until that point.
It was more times.
And I was always out to beat somebody else, and my object in getting better was to win. And I felt a failure if I came in second.
Mm-hmm. Even if you had bettered your previous time.
Yes. Yeah. So it's good theory, perhaps, but that isn't my experience.
Okay.
But I had to learn it, that theory. And
Let me excuse me for a minute. I just want to invite our viewers to phone in. We are eager to hear some of your comments, your thoughts, your experiences. We're talking here with Reverend Mark Follansbee about why should someone go to synagogue, church, temple? Why should someone do that? Why not just stay home in your own personal space and worship God that way? And we're talking about, right at the very moment, about some of the parameters of sharing and of being together with others and doing something corporately. And how does that become a therapeutic group or even a worshiping group in some sense? So we'd like you to to join us, and your voice will be amplified here as you call in, and we'll have a discussion with you, even though you're not physically in the room, yet your voice and your presence will be through the benefits of your telephone. So please call us here at 658-5165. 658-5165. We'd like to hear from you. Please call us and give us your thoughts. So, Mark, we haven't really made explicit how the link between sports and how that is connected with your men's group at the church, or how that's connected with celebrating the Holy Eucharist or worshiping God on the Jewish Sabbath on Friday night. But they're all somewhat linked, I think. Do we want to try to talk a little bit about those links, or?
Well, you better tell me what those links are. I think they're links in that they're joint, they're things people do together.
Yes.
And obviously some kinds of needs are being met there.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
The purpose, it seems to me, is quite different.
Yeah. Win the gold. It's a very different purpose than just.
But I think in the men's group, which, as I said, was not a church group. Half of those group were not, had no relationship to, more than half had no relationship to a worshiping congregation.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. The church.
One of those was in worship with us on Sunday at College Street Church, because his daughter, who happened to be the survivor of that mother's death, he was there for that, and he came back later to pick her up, and I said, "Oh, it's so nice to have. I see you're seeing the light and coming to worship." And and he said, "Go to hell." he knew I was teasing him.
He was going to tease you back.
Yeah. But it comes back to one's own sense of need and one sense of it. With what are we connected?
There's a need in us to be connected with others.
Yeah, there is.
Yeah, and, I think so.
And I think as we grow older and as we mature, I believe that we can see that the need seems to change, so that we need a supportive community, a safe place, but it's also have much wider connections than just a little group to which I really find
mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
basic support.
Mm-hmm. The need to be connected, I'm digressing here a little bit, but I remember my wife talking about when our children were very small and she was sort of trapped indoors in the house because she was not working outside of the home. I mean, she was full-time mother, and sometimes both kids would be ill, and she couldn't leave them very easily or get a babysitter, so she'd be stuck at home. And she'd have a friend who was in a similar situation sometimes to bring her children over, and they would stitch and bitch, you know? They would stitch and bitch to...
And there was a need for that.
There was a need, a big need for that.
Yeah.
Big need. And it's related to what you're saying.
Sure. I think we have a need to get to be close to people in a safe place so we can... bitch as well as stitch. It's an important part of defining the self.
I think that's been a sad thing about a lot of men in our society, is that we don't feel permission to stitch and bitch or some equivalent activity with others. We have to be more physically active. Maybe it's okay to go bike riding with another guy or bowling with another guy, but you don't have the chance in that activity to so directly bitch.
Well, there can be a lot in a team, an athletic team, a sports team. There can be a lot of real tearing down other people, complaining about the referee or the guy that blindsided me or
he fouled me and the referee didn't see it.
And of course, it spills over into the political arena.
Oh, doesn't it?
Yeah, and a lot of complaints about the other side, you know. Bitching is putting it politely, I think. we treat them as the enemy. And that's
destructive, ultimately.
It's destructive, and there's a basic need that's deeper than that, I believe.
Yeah, there's a wonderful story about this, which I will try to briefly tell. This is a true story. A folk singer was on tour in Europe some years ago, and he noticed that there were four old men who would sort of always show up at his concerts, and he couldn't figure out why. He couldn't help noticing them, and so he finally vowed that if they showed up again, he was going to charge down there and talk to them about why they were there. And so he did, they told him that they were following his concerts because he spoke and sang about during World War. I'm losing track of my wars. It was either one or two, where there were, where these four men during Christmas Eve night, or Christmas morning, they joined together with the Allied soldiers, exchanged gifts with each other, sang Christmas carols together, and then later in the day went back to shooting at each other. And it was a folk song that this man was singing about that occasion. Yeah. And these four old men said that when they had told people about what happened on the front, people wouldn't believe them. They thought, no, that couldn't happen. You know, the English and the Americans and the French, they weren't going to do that. They hated you and you hated them. And he said, no, it was all different on Christmas Eve. It was all different. And he says, we don't believe you. So when these four old men heard the singer singing this song about them and that occasion, suddenly they were blessed. They were proven to be truth speakers. It was just so delighted them. But again, this solidarity, this communion with one another was essential.
Communion is a word I don't use lightly, but I use it in the broad sense.
Mm-hmm.
And I think we're having communion basically when we are together.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
When we are open and honest and real with one another.
Yeah, and if we aren't the way you describe, then we're not having communion.
That's right. But the elements, however we serve the Lord's Supper, or the communion, or the Eucharist, or the Mass, whatever it is, they're always pointing us to the Spirit, God's Spirit, calling us into that kind of a communion.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. Absolutely.
They're the means of grace. They remind us of the grace that's already active. Yeah. Have we got time to talk about Kierkegaard?
We have 15 minutes, unless the next person who phones takes a lot of time, but we hope you will. We do invite you to call. Go ahead, Mark.
Well, I struggled with Kierkegaard in seminary, and a Danish philosopher, but I can't quote him now. I don't know really what he was doing or what he was saying, but I have this one story from him. He asked people to think about a congregation gathered for worship as a theater.
Hmm.
And he said, who are the various, in worship, who are the various parts in the, as if it were a theater?
Mm-hmm.
Who are the actors? Who's the audience? So forth. And he coupled that with saying, for him, the actors are the members of the congregation. The audience was God. And that the role of the clergy was to be a part of the, both part of the acting group, but also the prompters.
Mm-hmm.
To tell the actors the lines that they already knew.
That
to me is a striking illustration of the life, the real life of people that gather to worship God. With Jeremiah, God has written in our hearts,
mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
and called us to be with one another in our hearts. And I see this very much acted out in the risen Christ who comes at Pentecost as Spirit and breaks down all the barriers that separate people and brings them into a communion of the Spirit.
Mm-hmm.
Deep in our hearts, God is calling us. And worship will be there to remind us what our lines are. that fact that we're being called.
Yeah, I very much agree with you. That in fact, when we think of God and when we try to relate in our own internal way with God, we're already responding to God's prior love of us. It's our response. It's not like we're out in search of God. It's rather that God's in search of us, and we are finally responding, saying, okay, you've been searching for me for a long time, Lord, and I guess I'm willing to be found. At this point, maybe I wasn't ready to be found before. The Kierkegaard comment, I quite agree. As an Episcopalian priest, I've been very much aware for a long time that part of my role at worship, public worship, is to have a good sense of theater, and that the Eucharist, the Holy Communion service is an art form. It's it's an artistic form. It's and unless I look at it that way, it doesn't come alive as much. So what was it you said Kierkegaard was saying, that the clergy are the prompters?
Yes.
Mm-hmm.
They're on the stage, too.
Oh, yeah. Yeah.
But they don't tell us what they don't give us news. they remind us of the news we all, the good news we've already have accepted and acknowledged, and some and tend to forget, and live as if it were not true.
Yeah, I like that. that's a great concept and thought. It's a neat way to think about worship.
I could say one more thing about need here.
Surely.
And I'll refer to a recent meeting at the congregation where I sing in the choir.
Mm-hmm.
And we were gathered to speak and listen to one another, specifically on around the issue of civil unions.
Mm-hmm.
And knowing that there were divisions within the congregation. And so we gathered and we went through and created some guidelines as to how to behave with one another. That we need to speak only for ourselves.
Mm-hmm.
That we need to listen to one another respectfully.
Not to club each other.
Listen to learn. But behind it all was the sense that each of us had a need, and that we needed one another, and that especially I would need what the one who differed from me was going to say.
Mm-hmm.
But for me to be able to listen to somebody that I have a real difference with, and I want to fight against, or I'm threatened by, or who seems to threaten me because he's challenging me with his opposition. I need grace. I need an experience of the love of God that comes to me in can come to me
mm-hmm.
in a worshiping congregation, but especially one that's disciplined enough to be open to that spirit and open to the spirit in one another.
I want to ask you something about that, which it's sort of a difficult maybe answer, but I'll join in if you would like. I've noticed over the years that sometimes you're at worship with other people and you really feel the God spirit operative there. I mean, I'm not talking about any one particular worshiping group of people, Jews or Christians or whatever. You feel the movement of God's spirit. There are others where you just feel it's just a lot of words, and this, you don't feel a life or in the words. Have you noticed that?
Oh, yes.
And, how would you characterize the difference? Well, what makes the difference?
Well, sometimes the spirit isn't coming through. Sometimes we block the spirit. Sometimes we're not open to it.
It's not
sometimes
that God...
Sometimes my move is such. Sometimes it... It's the attitude. It's the expression of the people who are there, the leadership.
Mm-hmm.
You know, the clergy uses God talk to convince people to pay attention to what is being said, preached.
Right.
That's very discouraging to the spirit. But if I'm getting up and I'm wrestling with a problem and I'm hurt and feeling sorry for myself, I'm closing down.
Mm-hmm.
So sometimes there's just stuff going on that we're all involved in that we can't be together. Darkness of the soul, maybe.
Mm-hmm.
November blahs.
Okay, so when people...
Well, you said you'd help me on that. What did you want to say?
Well, I think you're doing very well. So, but you're saying in summary, you only have 2 minutes, I guess. You're saying in summary that sometimes the spirit is sort of not alive in a congregation, and another time it might be, and it depends upon where the people who are there worshiping are at. Is that one thing you're saying?
Well, I think the spirit is always alive.
Oh, yes, I would agree with that, yeah. But you don't feel it.
Yeah, and some the reason we don't feel it, number of reasons. We're not all, I'm not often receptive to the spirit.
Yeah. I hear you. You're an honest man, Mark.
Well,
it's true. We're distracted with other things or something.
That itself is a gift.
Yeah. Yeah.
It's a gift, isn't it? Because I recognize it. The Spirit's being honest with me. And I can't fake it.
Mm-hmm.
I've tried.
Well, I think I need to say goodbye because right. Our time is about up. Mark, I really appreciate your input here today. Each person who's been a guest on this topic have come at the topic with a very different perspective. They don't differ with each other, but they have a different way of looking at the issues, and it's delightful to see and to hear how you've addressed this. We've been talking with the Reverend Mark Follansbee, a United Church of Christ pastor, and he's been talking about the subject that we've been looking at for some time here in the last weeks. How is it that people will go to worship with other people? Why do they do that? And so we've been exploring that today and looking at it from Mark's point of view, which is why I wanted you here in the first place. I wanted to hear your point of view.
Well, it's been a real joy to have this conversation. I appreciate your encouragement with your invitation and your openness here.
Well, you've been very profound, and you've given me a lot to think about.
Wow.
You have.
Just me.
Hello, welcome to Struggles of the Spirit. I'm your host, the Reverend.